everybody. Thank you, Dr. Shivam, for a very nice introduction. And I pay my regards to my teacher, Professor Mahesh Bhandari. And thank you, Dave, for having me here. I'll try to restrict myself only to the prevention of low urinary tract infection this time. And I'll be talking to the patients who are and the public who are listening to this presentation. What is their role in preventing the infection? And what is our role as physicians in prevention? As Dr. Shivam said, when lady gets pain while passing urine, or experiences a burning sensation while passing urine, or has increased frequency of urination along with lower abdominal discomfort, they often believe that this is the urinary infection. In most situations, this is true, but instead, you have a self-diagnosis of infection. Let your physician make a diagnosis of urinary infection, because often these symptoms can also happen because of many other conditions and you fall in a trap. So be a little careful before you make a self-diagnosis. Now let me address this question. Why do ladies get UTI so often? And Dr. Shivam also made this small thing, that the females have a urethral passage which is very short as compared to males, and when a bacteria is shown here as a red thing moving in, it can travel this passage very easily, and once it reaches the urinary bladder, it multiplies from 1 to 2, 2 to 4, and it grows in exponential numbers, and when a critical number is crossed, the bacteria get attached to the lining of the urinary bladder and give rise to injection, what is called cystitis or urethritis. So it's because of the typical anatomy of the ladies, short urethra, that they get this infection. The key thing that we're discussing here is, why do ladies get recurrence of infection again and again? Having one infection is fine, but why do they get it again and again? And this is, if you see female anatomy, this, behind the bladder, there is uterus and vagina, which can often have number of bacteria which trickle down from vagina and colonize the area of the perineum, the female external genitalia. Behind the uterus, you have the rectum, wherein fecal matter gives rise to lot of bacteria, coliform bacteria. They also trickle down to anal verge, and then they colonize the area of the perineum. If ladies don't maintain good hygiene, they get lot of bacteria in the perineum, and this is what is called intraurethral colonization. Because of this intraurethral colonization, ladies get urinary infection again and again. But are there any more reasons? So why women get infection again and again? There are certain reasons in their in lower urinary tract because of which they get infection again and again. As I said, a greater intraurethral colonization, and then if there's opportunity for bacteria to go through the urethra, go into the bladder, and normally, if bacteria goes into the bladder and if a female voids in time and a female voids completely, they would not get urinary infection. But if there's some reason in the bladder, some reason in the female because of which the bacteria cannot be cleared out, then they have time inside the bladder to multiply and cause infection. So these are three reasons of occurrence of infection in low urinary tract: greater colonization, more entry into urethra, and disability on the part of bladder to completely clear bacteria out. Then you have certain factors in the body of the person overall. And this is, some ladies are genetically predisposed to have infection. Their mother had it, grandmother had it. That's why they are having it more often. Then some people are having poor nutrition because of which they get infection. And some people have comorbidities like diabetes or any such disorder which compromises their body resistance. So friends, the ladies have some factors within their lower urinary tract, and there are some factors in their body because of which they have recurrence of infection. Now, do all of these factors play a role in everybody? This is a key question. Now, if you were to see an adolescent girl and you see what factor plays a role in this age group, the intraurethral colonization can take place because of a greater incidence of constipation in these girls. Some of them who have a tendency for masturbation, they have an opportunity for enhanced entry of bacteria in urethra. Some girls have faulty voiding habits. They don't void in time. They retain their urine in the bladder for long, long hours, because of which the bladder does not empty and because of which bacteria do not go out. And that's why they have more urinary infection. If I were to talk about sexually active ladies, this age group, then in them, the intraepithelial colonization is more because of vaginal infection they can have. Many ladies have vaginosis, bacterial vaginosis, fungal bacterial infection, which trickle down to introitus and cause colonization. Because of frequent sexual activity, the bacteria can gain entry into the urethral passage. And some ladies have obstruction in the urethra because of the child delivery. They cannot empty their urinary bladder properly, so they get retarded elimination. And some ladies now at this age start developing diabetes, because of which the defenses are lowered. So if you see the third age of the ladies, the postmenopausal ladies, here the reason for greater introital colonization is hormonal withdrawal. They lose estrogen in the body, because of which there are changes in the epithelium of the genitalia, and the introitus becomes very prone for a number of bacterial growth. These ladies have reasons to be catheterized because of the diseases, because of the age, debility. So the catheter is the reason for enhanced entry of bacteria in the urinary bladder. Some of these ladies develop postmenopausal urethral obstruction, because of which they cannot void. So the bladder cannot eliminate bacteria. And many of them have diabetes, and because of aging, a poor body resistance. So the point I'm trying to make through these three slides, that not everybody will have all these factors. In one person, one factor will be dominant. In other person, other factor may be dominant. And more often than not, there are two, three factors playing a role in the patient. Now, the key thing here is, what have we been asking you as an individual, as a sufferer, or as a patient, to do to prevent the next attack of urinary tract infection? What is your role in prevention of infection? There are five strategies that you can take up as a patient. Try and reduce the colonization of bacteria in external genitalia, what we call medically as introitus. Then try to have a lesser opportunity. Try to minimize the entry of bacteria through urethra inside the bladder, strategy two. Third is, do something so that whatever bacteria have gained entrance in the urinary bladder, they are thrown out of the bladder and they're not allowed to stay in the bladder for long. And then, sure enough, do something to boost your innate resistance so that whenever disease occurs, you're able to fight it out. And then you may use some medical methods for prevention of the next attack. So these are five sound strategies that you as an individual can take up for prevention of next infection. Now let me elaborate what actually you need to do in each strategy. So what is the best practice to reduce the colonization of the external genitalia of the female? First and foremost is maintaining a good perineal hygiene. When ladies clean their bottom after defecation, they should not try to clean from front. If they try to clean from front, then the anal bacteria move forwards towards vaginal orifice and further forward towards urethral orifice and can create colonization. So they should instead clean the perineal area from behind, right? So the bacteria will not move forwards. They should try to control. If they have any infection in the vaginal area, treat this in time. Don't let it continue, don't let it go on. Because if that is the case, after sexual activity, this infection will go in the urethral passage and urinary bladder. So during sexual activity, you have to maintain proper hygiene. Don't use spermicidal jellies. They cause more infection. Instead, you can use lactobacillus gel inside the vaginal area. This gel gives healthy bacteria, which give competition to harmful bacteria. And harmful bacteria do not then grow in the vaginal area and do not colonize the perineum. Finally, elderly ladies can use hormonal cream, estradiol cream, this minimizes the intraepithelial colonization. So you can use any of these five, or two of these five, or three of these five strategies to bring down the population of bacteria in external genitalia. What could be a way to reduce entry of bacteria through the urethra? By that I mean from the external genitalia inside the urinary bladder. So first of all, whenever there's a chance for you to get catheterized, insist on clean, sound, aseptic precautions. And most important for sexually active ladies is they must maintain clean sexual practices. They must pass urine after every sexual act, and they must wash the genitalia thoroughly prior to sexual act if that is possible. What would be the best way to eliminate bacteria which have gone inside the urinary bladder? Enhance outward clearance. You must take plenty of liquids. That's the best way to throw the bacteria out. If you take about 3 liters of fluid well distributed in 24 hours, and you must involve yourself in proper emptying of urinary bladder. Empty urinary bladder timely and frequently so that bacteria do not get time to multiply. What else you can do? Look at this bacteria which is gaining insight into the urinary bladder. As I said, they multiply into many number and adhere to mucosa, and they become so many in the number. So you can use fruit juices, particularly cranberry juices or D-mannose formulations, which when you take, the bacteria which were adherent to mucosa, they get removed from mucosa of the urinary bladder and infection gets lowered. What can you do to boost your host resistance? You must take care of the blood sugar status, right? You must take care of any disease which is reducing your body resistance, like lymphoma, leukemias, radiation therapy. Pay attention to sound nutrition. Diet rich in fruits and juices prevent urinary infection. So friends, this is all what you can do as a patient yourself to take care that you don't fall sick with another attack of urinary infection. Now, what have we been doing as your physician to see that you don't get a urinary infection? What is our role? If you see here the urinary bladder and the urethra, urinary bladder is a reservoir. When it becomes full of urine, the muscle of the urinary bladder contracts to generate a pressure, and urethra opens, and then one can pass urine nicely in a good stream. This is the normal situation. But if in some patient there is a blockage in the urethral passage on account of narrowing or a stone or a tumor or whatever, there's a greater outlet resistance, the urinary bladder will not empty as nicely as it should. So there would be a problem. You can have infection. There are a group of patients, ladies, where because of age or because of diabetes or because of any neurological condition, the urinary bladder musculature becomes weak, and therefore it cannot generate enough pressure to empty the bladder completely. So the consequence of both a greater outlet resistance or a weakened pressure by the detrusor muscle, the consequence is that you can get residual urine in the urinary bladder and you can get infection. So we as a urologist realize that a leftover urine in urinary bladder can be a cause of recurrence of infection. So we try to treat this part for you. Treat your disorders, treat the bladder so that you don't get infection. And we also like to give you what is called chemoprophylaxis, where we advise you to take water with some medication after every sexual act so that you don't get post-coital urinary infection, or a continued bedtime prophylaxis for a long time. But that's not enough. We are aware that you continue to suffer from this infection too often, and we across the globe, scientists, urologists, physicians, gynecologists, pathologists, microbiologists, everybody is involved in research to find out what can be the other way to prevent urinary infection. And I'll take this opportunity to tell you and reassure you that we realize our role, and we are finding out new strategies and newer strategies what can be utilized to prevent infection. And I'll not take you into so many theoretical aspects, but just tell you that every occurrence of infection by us is regarded as an attack of infection, where there is an invader, and this invader has a bacteria which is a very brushy surface, and it has tail which can give its intricate rapid mobility inside the urine. So you have an invader which causes an attack, and then in your body the bladder behaves as a soil where the invader can attack. So for any infection to become clinically significant, you have to have a powerful pathogenic invader, and you have to have weakened defenses of urinary bladder, and a combination of both gives rise to the attack, the actual clinical infection. So conceptually, if someone has to prevent occurrence of infection, what we need to do is increase the defenses, upsize the defenses of the lower urinary tract, and this invader which moves so beautifully downsize the power of this bacteria. So we look into both aspects, how can we downsize the bacteria. If you look at this picture, this individual is wearing an armor, and it has the weapon. So invader, the strength of the invader lies in the protection armor, protective armor, and the nice weapon it has. So if you look at this invader, the bacteria, this bacteria is having a shell, first of all, which is a cell wall, which gives a protection. Then this bacteria has a brushy surface. I showed you that in this animation. Because of that brushes on its surface, it can attach to the lining of urinary bladder. It has powerful tail called flagella, because of which it can move very fast and can move up into the urinary bladder against the direction of urinary flow very easily. Then it has another coat over layer over the body, which is called capsule, which protects this bacteria from the body defenses. And then it has small passages from where it can suck even the smallest amount of nutrition from inside the urine. So friends, this bacteria is very powerful invader. It is has built-in armor, it has built-in weapons. So the strategy one in future for us is, how can we weaken the bacteria? We have used antibiotics for many years to kill this bacteria, but we realize that we can use vaccines, and we can use what is called anti-virulence factors. These two things have become our current focus of attention. Antibiotics anybody can use, but I want to share with you some thought on the future coming up for you, the vaccination approach to prevent urinary infection. There are large number of vaccine trials going on across the globe these days. Some of them have shown promise, and I must share with you that there's something called OM89, which is oral immunostimulant. It is extract of 18 types of various heat-killed E. coli, which are given to an individual who has had recurrence of infection, and if it is given, the episodes of recurrence can be reduced. This has come in our urology guidelines. But let me share you another interesting concept of anti-virulent factors. If you look at this roaring tiger and starts jumping at you, you're scared. So what you can only do is, you want to tame the tiger, not kill the tiger, right? You want to reduce the strength of the tiger, so the ferociousness is gone. So for this purpose, we use for bacteria what is called anti-virulent factor. These anti-virulent factor are small molecules which inhibit the communication between the two bacteria, three bacteria, four bacteria. So bacteria cannot talk to each other, and when they cannot talk to each other, they cannot produce toxins and biofilms. So our future strong strategy is going to reduce virulence of bacteria, not necessarily kill the bacteria. What I have been talking is about what's called interbacterial crosstalk. You know, in a classroom, when you have children sitting and they want to create a mischief, they need to talk to each other and plan. Right? In a similar manner, when many bacteria enter inside your urinary bladder, they crosstalk, and when they talk, they are able to produce more toxins, they are able to group up themselves in form of a film called biofilm, and then they are able to exchange amongst each other a capability to become resistant to the drugs, what's called drug resistance. So we have to somehow, as a physician or scientist, intercept interbacterial crosstalk. Or for doing this, we are intending to use what is called anti-virulence factors. And when you give them to the individual, to the patient, and when it reaches the urinary bladder on the bacterial population, bacteria are not able to produce toxin. They cannot group themselves, and they are eliminated. Look at this film. If some person as an individual has to row the boat against the current, how much difficulty this person will have. But if you have one boat being rowed by a group of people, then this boat can swim against any current in the river. So bacteria realize the strength of being together, and when they are inside the urinary bladder, they adhere to the surface of the urinary bladder like this. Every green blot that you see here is an individual bacteria. And imagine they are glued to each other, and they're layered on the lining of urinary bladder. So what we do, when we give anti-virulence factor, some of the bacteria in this film become weakened. They lost their virility, and then they cannot crosstalk. So a kind of a fracture is created in the biofilm, and the group of the bacteria is broken. The strength therefore goes down, and they cannot create infection. This is what I mean by calling, look at this weapon, look at the armor of this person. You can do what? You can de-armor this invader, right? Look at the thighs and look at the legs and the armor there. You can remove that also. And not only this, you can even take away the weapon from this invader. So if you can de-armor the invader, and if you can de-weaponize this invader, the strength of the bacteria will go, and you will not get this kind of fierce infection. And that is the strategy, one that we are looking at as a scientist, to weaken the bacteria. Let me quickly share with you, what are we looking at to strengthen the defenses of your urinary bladder? Over and above what you already do, what I have already told in the first part of my presentation, what can you do to prevent infection? Look at the soil, the bladder, the nature has given the urinary bladder to you. We can increase the defenses of urinary bladder. And look at this inside of the bladder, this black dot in the center is the bacteria. When the bacteria enters the urinary bladder mucosa secretes defensive proteins. You know, much like the way you get respiratory infection in your nose, as virus enters your nose, the nose secretes mucus and protects, glues with the bacteria or virus and throws out the infection. Nearly in a similar fashion, but at a much lesser scale, the lining of urinary bladder secretes the protein called defensins. Look at these dots, gray dots. And not only this, look at the blue dots. And these are catecholamines. This is another group of proteins secreted by this urinary bladder. And then these proteins go and surround this bacteria from all sides, launch a cationic attack on the bacteria. And then this bacteria loses the ability to attach to the lining of urinary bladder and gets eliminated out through the urethra. So these proteins are called antimicrobial peptides. Can we as a scientist induce the or augment the secretion of antimicrobial peptides? And the way is pretty simple. And this is vitamin D, D3. The cells, the lining cells of urinary bladder have vitamin D receptors, right? And the lining cells of urinary bladder can convert inactive vitamin D into active vitamin D. And it has been seen in ladies, postmenopausal ladies, those who have sufficient vitamin D in their body, their level of antimicrobial peptides is high. So, what I'm trying to hint at? I'm trying to hint at that if you maintain good vitamin D levels in your body, your antimicrobial peptide secretion in the urinary bladder will be sufficient enough to prevent occurrence of infection. And this fact has been seen in postmenopausal women. This is one area we are looking at. We hope something will definitely emerge in this aspect. If you look at the urinary bladder lining epithelium with a magnifying lens, small part magnified by scanning microscope, the lining will look something like this. Rough, bumpy inside lining of the urinary bladder. If you look with greater magnification, it looks like this. Multiple layers of the cell, and top layer of the cell is thicker and bigger. The cells are joining each other with tight junctions, and these cells will remind you of what is called umbrella, and these are cells called umbrella cells. When you go out in rainy weather, and if it rains heavily, raindrops fall in an umbrella. The umbrella has a coating over it. The raindrops fall, the shape of the umbrella is such that the raindrops will fall and they trickle out. In the same manner, nature has given us the lining cells of the urinary bladder are called umbrella cells. Over them, they have a lining, what is called GAG layer medically, glycoaminoglycone layer medically, and the cells look like umbrella, they're shaped like umbrella, so that if bacteria wants to sit over it, bacteria wants to get attached over it, it slips down its slippery surface. So we can, as a physician, improve the strength of the GAG layer. We are trying to put inside the bladder heparin solution, which will restore the GAG layer. And whenever we give females, the postmenopausal ladies, estrogen to be applied inside the vaginal lumen, this estrogen enhances the glycogen, the GAG layer. So what we're trying to do, we're trying to give you a new umbrella with a nice coating over it, so that in future, if bacteria comes inside the urinary bladder, it slips away from the surface and does not attach over it. So if I have to summarize, we as physicians can augment antimicrobial peptides by vitamin D supplementation. We can restore the GAG layer inside the urinary bladder mucosa, and that's what we call as pharmaco-augmentation of bladder defense. So friends, whatever I respect to all my lady listeners, we want to tell them and reassure them that you already know a number of ways to prevent infection in you, and there's a hope that we have more ways coming for prevention of infection in your body. We hope to change your look from towards the desert to the greenery, and I hope you will never get a urinary infection in the future again. Thank you very much for your patient listening.